Jean-Baptiste Avia, I'm CTO and co-founder of Screen. As I told you, I was working in the Apple Red Team, so I was performing attacks against internal Apple products like macOS, iOS, watches, and stuff like that. Before that, I was a pen tester, so I worked with like 500, Fortune 500 companies to startups to help them find their vulnerability, their security flaws, and help them secure that. So let's take a step back and look at what was an application, HTTP API, web application, whatever, like 20 years ago. 20 years ago, you had very few frameworks. Most of the work developers were doing was related to building stuff that we now have in frameworks, so like the SQL, the connection to the SQL database, the ORM, everything was built again and again by the developers. So like in your applications, most of the things were the code, and you had just a tiny bit of frameworks for low-level stuff like SQL driver, opening file, etc. In the 10 years later, the tendency swapped, right? So now when we build an application, we use a lot of frameworks. All of these are logic bricks that we can reuse. Okay, so no one is writing ORM anymore. We are all using Symfony or Active Record or whatever. The thing is, the security got much better because 20 years ago, all the vulnerabilities that were lying in the custom code each and every developer was writing again and again. Now they are all factored out in these frameworks, right? So the frameworks, most of them are open source. They are shared across all companies. So one security flaw in one framework is solved at some point, and all the community using these frameworks benefit from it, right? So the state of security went much better in the late 2010s. Now, it's like that. You have so many different applications spread across your company, spread across your organization. All of them are talking together. So we went from a model where the code was majority written custom to a model where you are using a lot of various bricks and reusing them across several of your applications. So what's an attack against business logic? 20 years ago, all your code was suffering from flaws because, like, yeah, no frameworks, everyone rewrites everything. Nowadays, these generic technical vulnerabilities that we were suffering about 20 years ago, like SQL injection, cross-site scripting, shell injection, they are getting much and more and more rare, all right? We don't have them much more. We still have them because we still write custom code, right? There is no choice. We still do bugs. We still have vulnerabilities. Now, these specific vulnerabilities are getting away. And so what we get is business logic vulnerabilities. It means, what is a business logic vulnerability? For instance, you are Domino's Pizzas. What is a business logic vulnerability for you? Depends on your business. So if you trigger a pizza order on Domino's Pizza website, it means that they are crafting the pizza, they are preparing the ingredients, they are telling a delivery guy to change its schedule to go at your place and to get your pizza, right? Each time someone orders a pizza online at Domino's, it's good for them because it's business, but also it's costly because of all of these actions they want to do. If some bug in Domino's Pizza system says allows someone to trigger like 1,000 of these actions in a few minutes, it's going to be terrible for them because the action is very costly. Okay, so if I'm attacking Domino's Pizza like that, it's not an attack against their database to steal data or to take over their server. No, it's an attack against their business logic. And that's how you can retrieve, you can cause trouble to a company. So that's what your company looks like from applications or APIs point of view, right? Each of the circle is an HTTP API, and so is talking to others through HTTP APIs. Back in the days, we were protecting such things with a web application firewall, right? Something in the edge of the network, so like a reverse proxy, something that is doing the security. But you see, doing the security on the edge is not the best for such an infrastructure. You cannot prevent any business logic attack with that, because only having the edge means what's happened to the depth of my network. I don't have this information. I cannot know what a service in very deep in my network is doing. Our vision is to democratize the security and to distribute it amongst all of the applications. So the goal is not to have any more one single tenant web application firewall on the edge of the network, rather to distribute the security logic inside each of your applications. In this way, if an attack happens at some point, you can easily check each and every of the path the attack is taking, and maybe if some of these elements concern a sensitive business logic function, you would be able to detect it and to block it. So, how can we do this in practice? It's the theory is okay, putting the security logic inside my applications looks fine, it looks logic, because that's where we are performing the sensitive business actions. Though, practically speaking, it's not trivial. So let's build our toolbox and let's see how we can do it in practice. First, let's assume we have a track method. All right, so if I call this track method and I provide it with an event name, then I can easily put that in my source code, right? And everywhere I will be able to change my code, my application's code, for it, having it to record the sensitive actions that are done. First item in our toolbox. The way to apply it would be to change all of my applications with this information, right? So for instance, if I generate a user token, that's a sensitive information, so I want to record it. If I reset a user password, that's sensitive as well. And for any login, obviously login is a big source of abuses, so I want to know that as well. Second item in our toolbox that we need is an event stream, right? Because all of my applications are gonna generate events when something sensitive is called, so we need to gather it somewhere. An event stream sounds like the perfect place to gather all of it. Then, okay, we have this sensitive information. We need to process them and analyze them. We want to detect when a security anomaly or an attack is happening. This is where we are gonna do it. And last but not least, if we detect an attack, if we detect an anomaly, then we want to respond, right? So I want to send back to my application a response, like block this user or prevent this function from being called or call the pager, I don't know. But you want to respond if you find something. So the way we could put all of it together in our as someone trying to secure APIs, the way I want to write this down could be like that. So if the rate of user token generation is unusual, then I want to respond and I want to lock the user account. Also, I want to be alerted and I want to send a webhook. Other example, if I want to count the user impersonation and this rate of user impersonation is above 10 over the last 1 minute, then I want to raise an exception, block the IP, and maybe call a pager. Who know this screen? Do you know which software it's taken from? New Relic, exactly. So New Relic is the tool many, many ops and many, many companies use to measure performance. 20 years ago, the way we were measuring performance was at the edge of the network. We were computing the time taken for a response to be generated. Okay, that was working, that's practical. Okay, how long does this path to complete? But now, with New Relic, that is put inside your application and that uses dynamic instrumentation to record the time spent by Python in this case, the database, the time spent in the reverse proxy, we have much better visibility than only the time taken by the request. So, think about it. In the last 20 years, we moved the application performance monitoring from the edge of the network to inside the applications. This is even one of the enablers of DevOps, because thanks to such tools, we had developers working with ops on the same tool. Look. Your code is taking too much time. Yeah, but because your database is slow. And that's how we manage to build relationships between ops and developers. That's really one of the pillars of the emergence of DevOps. It's the same for security. Security should now be spread and distributed across all of your HTTP application, HTTP APIs. So how can we do this at scale? This is a simple source code, right? When a function is working, well, you have function one, function two, at some point, authenticate is called, okay? What we want to do is automatically being able to say, all right, authenticate, I want to instrument it. I want to know when authenticate is called. One way to do it is to ask all of your developers to patch their code base, to track the sensitive functions. That's not the best, because that's very slow. Sprints are like 2 weeks, and so you would need a lot of time to update all of your code base. What we want to do is hook this function, and so automatically being able remotely to say, all right, I want to hook authenticate. That's how your antivirus works, right? They hook all of the open or read functions on your Windows or on your Linux servers. This way, without modifying any of your existing libraries, you are able to secure all the calls that are made to open or read. Okay, doing the same techniques as using the same techniques as antivirus, we can easily modify the behavior of our programs and, without changing the source code, record all of the calls to the functions we want. If we want to do it dynamically, well, we just have, instead of hard coding this, we just have to read this information remotely. So that's how you would do it in Ruby. It's quite easy. It's really 12 lines of code. In Java, it's a bit more complicated. You need to have some libraries. Well, Java is compiled. That's much harder, but still doable. So if you have such a tool to do that, what can you do? You can retrieve all the context you want, like the authenticated user, custom business information, custom code, any HTTP value, the previous service call, all the spanning information across all the nodes of your microservices. You could also do it in a very, very performant way. That's an agent. You can use a dedicated thread to send and to stream events to the event stream, and everything else in the application is very fast because you will never block the request. So how could this work at scale? If you take again your infrastructure and all of your applications, then you will be able to describe, for instance, in the JSON files, the name of the functions and class and methods you want to instrument. All right? Then all of your applications in which you have put the libraries, that is, using the dedicated thread to talk to the event stream, these applications will retrieve this JSON file and will be able to instrument all of your code. So you don't have to bother the developers, and you can just pick all the relevant information you want in your infrastructure. So you could analyze a lot and lot of things, like the volume of calls, the actions performed by an IP, detect unusual activity, anomalies, and even check the logic flows. Responding, you can imagine a lot of things as well, like setting an account read-only, log a user out, deny access to some specific functions. So you're probably aware of that, but 2 months ago, Facebook got 50 million user accounts stolen. No SQL injection, no database theft, no server takeover, nothing like that. It was all business logic flaws. How did it work? I don't work at Facebook, but I guess that's how their services, what their services look like. You had a video uploader. You were able to upload a video on the behalf of someone else. If you were doing that, the video uploader was generating a token on the behalf of the person of the person you were impersonating. So the attacker managed to chain 3 logic bugs that Facebook did not detect, and this is what allowed them to gather all of the user token. So how would I solve it if I were Facebook? So I would track using the system we described previously. When a user is impersonated and when a token is generated, then using 2 simple rules, like I want to know when a user is calling the impersonation too much, or I want to know when a user is calling the generate token too much, this would be enough to detect such attacks. That's kind of the tools you can use. Obviously, anomaly detection, it's not something trivial, but it's something solved. It's not like rocket science. And so if you put everything at scale, quite easily, you can see you have your JSON to describe all the things you want to record, event stream, processing and analysis engine, and you send the response back to your applications. And that's how you would be able to solve plenty of business logic security issues. Some stuff are in a very simple open source project. Don't use it in production, but you can take a look for inspiration. Thanks a lot.